often people will say to me, what's the greatest story you've ever covered? And they assume that it was Watergate, since I was on the South on the day Nixon resigned. But I always say that is not the greatest story I covered. The greatest story I covered was February 12, 1973, the return of the prisoners. Because if you had been on the tarmac that day, you would have gotten a refresher course in the resilience of the human spirit. The resilience of the human spirit against all manner of depredation and deprivation, physical, emotional, mental. And to see those guys come off the C-141 transports, broken in body, but not in the least broken in spirit, was a tribute. And I've told this story hundreds of times. The same thing always happens. The hair on my arms is standing on edge here, just remembering the drama, the impact of that moment. It is the only story I've covered in 45 years as a reporter where reporters were in tears, just like everybody else on the tarmac. It was a monumental day, and a day for celebration. And I'm especially honored to have a chance, even as the backup catcher here, to be able to be on the panel with both these distinguished gentlemen. So let's get to what they have to say, not what I have to say. Senator, you have said that Ernie Brace's story should be told to every American. What do you hope people take away from his story, which we're all going to see in just a little bit? And what lessons can we learn from Ernie?
Well, I think one of the lessons we can learn from Ernie Brace is that the human spirit can overcome incredible odds and incredible difficulties and pain and suffering and still emerge stronger than that trial by fire. If I might just give you a slight amount of background, I was in a camp that we called the plantation. And at one end was a room with two American pilots, Air Force pilots, an empty cell. And behind my cell on the other side was an empty cell. And all of a sudden one day I heard noise in the cell behind me, and that was unusual because that cell had never been used. And to make a long story short, over a period of several weeks of Ernie and I tapping to each other, we finally connected up. And I asked Ernie, I said, have you been here more than 2 years? Yes. And I said, tap twice. Yes, yes. More than 3 years? Yes. More than 4 years? Yes. More than 5 years? Yes. More than 6 years? And before Ernie had come to that prison camp, he'd been kept in the most unspeakable conditions, in the most incredible punishments, where he was attempted to escape. And the other difficulty that he had, and I won't go into a lot of the details, is that having been an Air America pilot, a contract pilot, he didn't have the same protections under the Geneva Conventions. So it was we always knew and believed, those of us that were Air Force and Navy pilots, that we were going home someday. Ernie knew that, but there was an extra cloud over there as to whether the Vietnamese would ever declare him. One of the things the Vietnamese did is not tell people, his families, not reveal the names. And yet Ernie persevered, he buoyed our spirits, and he had a lot of great stories to tell us about his previous experiences. And a special bond was forged between him and me, particularly because I was the first to communicate with him in, how many years was it? Six?
Three and a half,
that
was brought
me
into Hanoi.
And so,
most Ernie, what does it mean to you being here, sitting on the stage next to your friend, Senator McCain, telling your story, telling this story in detail, really, for the first time?
Well, I'd been in solitary confinement for so long, I hadn't heard an American for over 3.5 years. And when I heard the shave and a haircut, I thought, well, that's nice, there's an American next door, or are they trying to trick me? So I didn't respond right away. It took John a couple days to get me on the wall. Finally, he quit tapping, shaving a haircut, and he started just thumping 1, 2, 3, 4. And I started counting, and I realized I shouldn't be saying the alphabet. So I didn't even get that one on the first go around. He came up and he started again. He was persistent. And I got put here to the wall. but Larry gets along and he says, if you hear me, buddy, knock two times, boom, boom. He got all excited.
I'll fast forward just a little bit. I'm struck by the irony that the two of you had a remarkable relationship, but you'd never met. But then you finally met, I think at a White House event for returning prisoners. Was that the day the picture of you was taken with President Nixon? You were on crutches?
Yes. And of course, I was so happy to see Ernie. I was just overjoyed to be able to see this great American who was able to survive so much and that I feel very close and dear to all these years. Those people that I know best and love most are those that I had the honor of spending time with. And believe me, I hear from one of them at least every day. Now, John, why did you say, why didn't you vote for, why, I don't understand, what did we talk to? So it's very rare that I get a letter from, or a phone call from one of my buddies saying, great job. So anyway, we kind of have a special bond all these years. A couple of old geezers sitting around waiting for them to blow the cavalry charge.